Good morning, everybody. Hope you guys are doing great on this beautiful Sunday. Y'all stand on up and we'll get started in worship.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so amazing. That love so amazing. Yeah. Jesus Messiah. The name above all names. Oh, blessed. Deep, your grace is more. where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. To you when temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Oh Jesus, you're my hope and strength. Lord, I need.
Good morning. Welcome to our online service at First Baptist Church of Dover. Thank you for being a part. Wanted to encourage you with a verse. It's the same verse that Paul encouraged the Philippians with at the end of his letter to them. They were going through some troubles, and he says this to them. He says, "My God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus." Now, as the country starts opening up, a new type of certainty kind of confronts us. We can be confident as his children that he will supply us with our needs. And to that, I would join Paul with what he says next in Philippians 4:20, "To God and Father, to our God and Father, be glory forever and ever. Amen." Please join me in prayer. Father, you are the fountain of our joy. You are the provider of our needs. You lead us beside still waters. You restore our souls. You lead us in paths of righteousness. Help us to forsake fear and embrace and trust your truth, which you have revealed to us in your Son, our Lord and Master Jesus. Help us to live consistently with the righteousness that you have imputed to us through him. And in his name we pray. Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring me. sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was a cause. Brought me life, and I know that it is finished. And I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know. I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Holy, holy.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you. Where you my sin washed white, I owe all to you. Yes, I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless. Peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, it comes flowing down. At the cross, at the I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. Yes, I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. Lord, I owe all to you. Is found here on holy ground. Here I bow down. Here I
arms open wide here. You saved my life, here I bow down, here I bow. God, I just want to say thank you so much for giving us the means to worship you like this in this country where we can freely do this. Lord, I know that your hand is over these times. We know that we can trust you. Lord, here our hope is found in the name of Christ Jesus. I pray that you just give us a great morning in the name of our Savior. Amen.
All right, man, wasn't that great worship? I'll tell you what, it's hard. I guess it is for them to sing in an empty sanctuary, but I know every week they're preparing my heart to preach and to bring God's word to you. So thank you, praise team, for some wonderful, wonderful worship and wonderful truths in the message of those songs, okay? Hey, listen, be finding Psalm 23, and this will be our last message in this series, Certainty for Uncertain Times, okay? So find Psalm 23, verse 6. Hey, and while you're doing that, let me just tell you, today is it's such a special day because today is Ezra Nash Paxton's birthday. And at some point between 10 and 11 o'clock tonight, he will be a whopping 1 year old. Not years old, but just 1 year old, okay? And man, it's a great day. So as far as I'm concerned, man, you can take off work tomorrow. Don't go in. Get a paid holiday. Just tell your boss what the occasion is, and I'm sure you'll have a great, good excuse for that. Hey, listen, I want to show you about a 15-second video. I've been asking Ezra some questions, trying to teach him things and learn some things, so I'm trying to pick his brain a little bit. And so I've got a little quick video I want you to watch. I think you'll be blessed by it.
Ezra, do you love your Papa Jay? You love your Papa Jay.
Isn't that awesome? I mean, that dude, he is. Now listen, I'm not so sure he ought to be drinking gas from that little red gas can that goes with his little lawnmower, but I'm not worried about him drinking gas. What I'm concerned about is that he loves his Papa Jay. Amen? So that was so wonderful, and I know you're blessed by that, probably not half as much as I am, okay? All right, let's get down to business. Psalm 23. Now, the title of our series is Certainty for Uncertain Times, you know, and we were really going a different direction a few months ago, and then all of this stuff hit, and I just felt drawn to Psalm 23 because what I see there is certainty for uncertain times. And man, listen, nothing's more uncertain than where we are now, uncertain health-wise, financial-wise, all those things. Things are just so up in the air. And man, I just felt like we needed something rock solid to build upon and stand upon. And that's really what we see, I think, in Psalm 23. Now, what I want to do here is I want to do kind of what we've been doing is I want to review where we've been, but I want to read the passage at the same time. We'll take care of two things at one time, okay? So we'll put the screen up, the review screen up for you, and then I'll read the passages and we'll just go through each verse, all right? So let's start Psalm 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. What a declaration. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. And what we talked about in week one was that we can be certain of his provision. I shall not be in want. Hey, he's going to meet my needs, certain of his provision. Verse 2, he makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. We talked in week two about the green pastures of His Word and the still water of His Spirit, and it's there that we find peace. And so we can be certain of His peace. Verse 3, He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Well, we said we can be certain of His purpose. Listen, God's purpose is always to restore us. It's always to bring us back into a closer relationship with Him. And so we talked about certainty of His purpose. Verse 4, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. And so we talked about the fact that we can be certain of God's presence. He says, I am with you. And He's told us in other places, I'll never leave you and never forsake you. Certain of His presence. Verse 5, You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup overflows. We can be certain of God's preparation. He prepares a table. That is, God has prepared us for everything in this life, for salvation and also sanctification. And we talked about His preparation. You can be certain of that, even in this old crazy, evil, many times world in which we live. Verse 6, the one for today. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Listen, we can be certain of God's promise. He makes some promises in verse 6 that we're going to dive into and dissect, but they just give us so much confidence. And I want you to have that. When you can say the Lord is my shepherd, man, you can be certain of these promises. And so we're going to look at those. What happens to me is, if you really look at this psalm and meditate on it, what happens is it's almost as though David saves the best for last. I mean, it seems like you read verse 1, verse 2, and that's good, and that's good, and that's good. But then you get to verse 6, and it's just like, man, he says, surely goodness and mercy is going to follow me all these days that I live. And then I get to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. It's just like He saves the best for last. And hey, guess what? That's what God does sometimes. It seems like, now the devil does right opposite of that. The devil wants you to... He wants you to take things right now. You may not be ready for it right now, but he wants you, I deserve it, and I deserve it right now. And the devil wants you to jump in and take it right now. Maybe it's sex. You're not ready for it. You're not married. You're not mature, but you take it because I want that. And so you get it now. Or maybe it's debt. You know, I want to buy the car and the new car now. I want the house now. And he says, man, you deserve it. Go for it. But he never shows you the consequences that come later. He gives you, if you could say it, the best now, and it goes downhill from there. But not so with God. God gives us, he saves the best for us. The devil wants you to take it now and suffer consequences later. Listen to this verse. Proverbs 20, verse 17. The bread of deceit is sweet. In other words, it tastes good right now. What tastes good? But afterward, a man's mouth will be filled with gravel. He's a liar. He's a deceiver. He wants you to take it now and then suffer later. God says, man, it's good now, but it just gets better. He saves the best for last. Do you remember when Jesus turned the water into wine? Do you remember what the guests came to him and said? They said, man, what's going on here? Most time, the host, they give the best wine first and then give the cruddy stuff later as the night wears on. But Jesus, and they came to his family and said, man, you saved the best for last. That's what God does many, many times. And I think that's what I see as I look in this psalm. He just says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And man, if that's not good enough, I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He saves the best. Do you remember that song? I think it was the Gaithers who did it. It says, if he keeps on blessing and blessing, if he keeps on giving a song, he says, if he keeps on getting richer and richer, and he keeps pouring it on, he says, if it keeps getting better and better, oh Lord, I don't know what I'm going to do. And that's kind of the way I see Psalm 23, verse 6. If it keeps getting better and better, I don't know what I'm going to do. It reminds me of another song. Every day with Jesus is, there's nobody in here to tell me, sweet. Hope you said it at home. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. And that's what I see in Psalm 23, okay? So let's look at these promises. You can be certain of several promises from this verse of Scripture. Number one, the benefits of his pursuit. And I want you to write out beside that, if you're taking notes, two words that come straight from Scripture, goodness and mercy, okay? The benefits of his pursuit of us is that goodness and mercy come our way. Now, before we look at the goodness and mercy, I want you to notice the very first word of verse 6. You see it? Surely. Surely. Now, listen, I just love that word. In other words, that's the way things come. Listen, if we ever need something that was sure, man, it's right now. Amen? I mean, it's so uncertain. And man, it just seems like, man, when we don't know what to do, we better talk to the one who knows what's going on when we don't know what's going on. When things are uncertain, well, we better talk to the one who is certain and who does know what's going on. And so he says, God is a sure God, okay? Surely. Goodness and mercy will fall. I just love that. I love that word, surely. He doesn't say, can you imagine, talking about it saves the best for the last, can you imagine him reading that verse and, you know, the Lord's my shepherd, shall not want, he makes me like, does all that stuff. Get to verse 6 and he says, hopefully, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of life. Or maybe goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. You know, he doesn't say that. No, he says, surely, it's going to happen. Our God is a sure God. Listen, we our mood may change, but God's mood doesn't change. Our mind may change, God's mind doesn't change. The way we do things, we think about it, it changes. Man, we just fly by night sometimes, fly by the seat of our pants kind of people. But God is not that way. Listen, when we falter, he doesn't falter. It reminds me of that passage, even when we are faithless, man, God is faithful. Okay? And so that's what I get out of that word, surely, surely, surely. He talks about his devotion. So he says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. So now listen, now you may misunderstand that and say, well, man, listen, the Lord is my shepherd and not everything that happens to me is good. That's not what it's saying. So let me give you a timeless truth right off the bat. Here it is. When the Bible says that goodness and mercy follows us all the days of our lives, that does not mean that everything that happens to us will be good. But it does mean that God will use everything that happens to you for your good. You see, something happens, you say, man, that wasn't good. My health, look at this, I got a bad result. Man, that's not good, or I had a wreck, or I failed that class, and it's just not good. No, he's not saying that those things are good. He's saying he's going to take those things and he's going to turn them into good. Maybe he allowed that to come to you because, man, he's wanting to grow you. He's wanting to grow your trust in him. He's wanting to grow your faith. And sometimes those things happen and you look at them and you say, man, they're not good. But listen, you don't see the beginning and the end. You don't see the before, the middle, and the after. But God does. He sees the big picture. And he says, listen, I'm going to make it good. I'm going to turn it into good. Do you know what's going on here? Psalm 23, verse 6 is really the Romans 8:28 of the Old Testament. You remember Romans 8:28? Man, that's a great verse. Here it is. We know, what do we know? Well, we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. God's saying, listen, hey, I'm going to work everything out together for good. And that's why he says goodness. You can count on his goodness no matter what happens. God's going to make it good. That's what he said. David said that in Psalm 23. Paul says that in Romans 8:28. And so goodness is going to follow us. And listen, hey, by the way, did you know that anything that happens to you that's good comes from God? Anything. Listen, if you look at your life and something happens to you, you say, well, boy, that was good. Listen, I don't know what it could be anything. You know, I got that unexpected check in the mail, or I got that great parking lot right up front, or whatever. Listen, if you say, man, that was good, hey, guess what? That came from God. It doesn't matter how big it is. It doesn't matter how small it is or how very simple it might be. If it was good, it came from God, and I'll show you why. Here it is, James 1:17. Every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above. Every good thing and every perfect gift comes from God above. Okay? So we're promised goodness. But not only goodness, we're promised mercy. Now listen, I don't know about you, but I need mercy. Hey, I take that back. I do know about you. You need mercy too, okay? Amen? I mean, we need mercy. And God gives mercy. You say, well, what is mercy? You know, the best way to describe to me mercy is that it's the flip side of grace, all right? So I've given you these definitions before, and maybe it'll stick, and I hope you'll get it, okay? What is mercy? Mercy, first of all, is that God does not give me what I do deserve. That's mercy. He doesn't give me what I deserve. I deserve judgment. I deserve punishment. I deserve hell. But God's mercy says, I'm not going to give you what you deserve. That's mercy, okay? Well, what about grace? Grace is God does give me what I don't deserve, what I do not deserve. In other words, man, I don't deserve forgiveness, but God says, I'm going to give you forgiveness. I don't deserve reconciliation. I don't deserve love. I certainly don't deserve heaven. But God says, in my grace, I'm going to give you what you don't deserve. In my mercy, I'm not going to give you what you do deserve. Okay? So that's the difference in mercy and grace. It was a cold winter's night in 1935. Fiorello LaGuardia was the mayor of New York City. And as he was off to do, he would go to night court. He would go down to the courthouse at night when the judge would be hearing all the cases and checking people in and sending them to jail and doing all that stuff. And so Mayor LaGuardia went down there and he told the judge, he said, you go home, I'll take over. And so he sat on the bench and he was adjudicating these cases that came before him. And all of a sudden there was this, you might say a tattered, elderly woman that came and stood before him. And the charge was against her was read to the court, to the mayor. And the charge against her was stealing a loaf of bread. This is 1935. And the judge, how do you plead? And she said, well, judge, mayor, she said, I'm a grandmother. My daughter is sick, and she's very sick, and her husband has left us. He's just deserted us. And she's sick, she can't do it. And she has several children. They're my grandchildren. And man, we don't have anything to cover. There's nothing to eat. And so, Your Honor, I'm guilty. I stole that loaf of bread. Well, the store owner was there, and he refused to drop the charges, and he just said, Judge, we live in a terrible neighborhood. It's one of the worst in the city, and you can't let her off. It'll send a terrible message to other people. They'll all be stealing, and everybody think they can get away with it. And listen, she deserves justice. She deserves punishment, and my heart is as big as anybody's. But you can't let her off, and so she must be punished. The law demands that she be punished. Well, the judge looked out at this elderly lady and the grandmother, and he said, "Ma'am, I'm sorry." He said, "But the law does demand justice, and you've pleaded guilty, and listen." He said, the sentence I pronounce is $10 fine or 10 days in jail. It's up to you. And of course, she didn't have the $10. And as he was pronouncing the sentence, he reached back into his wallet and he pulled out a $10 bill. And he said, it's $10 or 10 days in jail. And he said, and here's the $10 fine. And he took his hat and he gave it to the bailiff. And he said, here's the $10 for the fine. But I want you to pass this hat around this entire courtroom. And everybody in this courtroom is fined 50 cents. For living in a neighborhood where an elderly grandmother has to go and steal a loaf of bread to feed her grandchildren. Well, the word got out what he did. There was a reporter there, and the New York newspapers the next morning reported what he had done. And $47.50 were collected that night from people who they were just made to do it. The store owner who brought the charge, he was made to give 50 cents. And there's a lot of petty criminals who were there. They were all made to give 50 cents. And the policemen who were standing and doing their job, they all had to give 50 cents. $47.50. And the judge says, you give it to that lady. Give it to that grand. And so that's what they did. And so what I'm trying to say to you and show to you and picture for you is this. That woman deserved justice. She deserved punishment. But what she got was mercy. right? She deserved justice. She got mercy. She deserved to spend the night in the city jail, but she got to go home. She deserved to be spend the next 10 days with criminals, but she got to go home and be with her family. She deserved justice. She got mercy. And praise God, that's what he gives us. He doesn't give us what we deserve. And so he's saying, goodness and mercy are going to follow you. And I'm so grateful for mercy. Let me give you a verse about mercy. Lamentations 3, verse 22. Because of the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed. Think about that. Listen, if it wasn't for God's mercy, you'd be wiped out. You'd be consumed by the holiness and the wrath and the punishment of God. But it's because of his mercies you're not. He says, your compassions do not fail. They are new every morning. Hallelujah. I need that. You need that. And so what David is saying, he says, goodness and mercy will follow me. And man, how we need goodness and how we need mercy. John Phillips, a great commentator, put it this way. We need both goodness and mercy. We need goodness for our steps. We need mercy for our stumbles. God's goodness supplies me. God's mercy soothes me. God's goodness helps me. God's mercy heals me. God's goodness provides, while God's mercy pardons. And so, goodness and mercy. So we've looked at two words, or three words, really. We've looked at surely, we've looked at goodness, and we've looked at mercy. Now I want you to look at one other word, just in the first part of verse 6. Look at it if you will. Verse 6, surely goodness and mercy will, now look at this, follow me. I want you to notice that word follow. The Hebrew word follow literally means to pursue, to chase after. Now picture that. Let that sink in. David is saying, surely, not maybe, not hopefully, not could be. He says, surely goodness and mercy is going to pursue you. It's going to chase after you. And by the way, if you say the Lord is my shepherd, you can't outrun his goodness and mercy, man. He's going to track you down and pour out goodness and mercy. Isn't that great? He says goodness and mercy is going to follow you, pursue you, chase after you all the days of your life. And so he says, man, it's going to come after me. I like the way Max Lucado put it. He said this, if the Lord is the shepherd who leads the flock, his goodness and mercy are the two sheepdogs that guard the rear of the flock. Amen. So the Lord's leading the flock, and goodness and mercy are the sheepdogs chasing after the flock. And so when you say the Lord is my shepherd, you have mercy and grace following. Now listen, here's the thing that's so interesting to me about this, is normally when we think about God, we think about following God, right? What did David say? David said, I'm a man after God's own heart. Okay, so he's following God. And so a lot of times that's what we think about. I'm pursuing God. I'm going for the prize. The upward call of God in Christ Jesus. We're following God. But in this passage, what we see is, man, God following us, God chasing after us. And listen, if you really think about it, and I just went back and I just started thinking about it. There's a lot of examples in the scripture where God follows us. Now we follow, and listen, he follows us if we're his children following him. If we say the Lord is my shepherd, man, he's following us, okay? I want to give you some examples, and here's the thing about these examples. When God follows us, a lot of times these examples, they come during times of failure when we mess it up. They come during storms that we're going through. And in the midst of our failure, in the midst of our storms, the amazing thing is God's pursuing us the whole time. So let me give you a few examples. First of all, you hardly get into the Bible itself in Genesis chapter 3, and what do we find? We see God pursuing Adam and Eve. They failed, they messed up, they disobeyed, and what's going on in chapter 3? Well, man, they're hiding in the bushes, and God's pursuing them. God's following them. God's coming after them. I think about Moses in the wilderness in Exodus chapter 3. Moses has killed an Egyptian, and man, he's on the run. He's fearing for his life, and he goes out into the wilderness. There's nobody out there. He's all alone. Talk about isolation. He's out there, but listen, he's not alone because God's following him. God's chasing him down even in the midst of his failure, because now we see a burning bush. God is there pursuing him. I think about Jonah in Jonah chapter 1. Jonah disobeys. God says, go to Nineveh. He says, I'm not going to Nineveh. I'm going this way. And so what happens? God chases him down. God pursues him even in the midst of his disobedience. I think about the disciples. They're in the midst of a storm. They're out in their boat, and I mean the storm is raging, the wind's blowing, the waves are coming, and they're about to go down, and they're about to die. What has happened in the midst of their storm? Well, here comes Jesus. Man, he's walking on the water, right? Because he pursued them. He followed them even into their storm. I think about Lazarus. I mean, listen, he had died. The family's hurt and they're heartbroken, and Jesus follows him into death, into that tomb, and says, come on, get up and come out of that tomb. He followed him into there in John chapter 11. Then I think about Peter. Peter had failed the Lord. He denied him three times, and Jesus had been crucified. He's dead and gone. And man, Peter says, man, the only thing I know to do is to go back to fishing. I'm going to go fishing. That's the only thing I know to do. And so he's out there fishing. And who's up on the beach? Man, Jesus is on the beach and he's fixing breakfast. He's followed him. He's chased him down. Even in his failure, he's pursued Peter. And then there's one other person, there's an example of who he follows, and that is you and me. He follows us. Because what did Jesus say? Luke chapter 19. The Bible says, I've come to do what? To seek. He said, I'm seeking to save those who are lost. I'm going to sit. Listen, thank the Lord he sought you. Amen. He sought me. Amen. He seeks us. And so, yes, the Lord is my shepherd and I'm following him. But listen, he's following me, chasing me down with his goodness and his mercy to pour out into my life. Okay? And so, listen, he's following. Have you ever sensed that the Lord's following you? Listen, maybe you failed. Maybe you've messed it up. And even right now, you just sense, man, God's following me. Well, sure he is. He just wants you to turn around. His arms are outstretched to you. Listen, maybe you're here and you can't say, let's just pull over and park for a second. You can't say, the Lord is my shepherd. You know what? He's pursuing you. He's come to seek and to save you. You're lost. And his arms are outstretched. Won't you just turn to him? Why don't you turn from your sin? And why don't you just receive him and what he did at the cross and say, the Lord is my shepherd. He's my master. Listen, won't you do that? He's chasing you. He's following you. Okay? So those are the benefits. What wonderful benefits of his pursuing me. Goodness and mercy. All right, number two. Not only the benefits of his pursuit, goodness and mercy, but the beauty of his place. And I want you to write out beside that the phrase, these come right from Scripture, goodness and mercy, and then the Lord. The beauty of his place. What's his place? Well, his place is heaven. And the beauty of heaven is the Lord. Notice he says the house of the Lord, the Lord, the Lord, the Lord. The beauty of heaven is the Lord. Now, there's a great word here in this psalm, and I want you to see it. Normally we would just pass right on by it, but look at it. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and you know what that word is? It's a conjunction. You know your parts of speech and so forth? It's a conjunction. What do conjunctions do? Man, they link words together. They link phrases and sentences together. I can remember, you remember this when you were a kid and you're in there watching cartoons on Saturday morning. It's Tom and Jerry and Bugs Bunny and Roadrunner and all of that. And in between those cartoons, they had come up with these little songs about the parts of speech and different English and grammar and all that kind of stuff. And I can even still remember to this day. Conjunction, junction, what's your function? I'm hooking up words and making them function. Am I the only one that remembers that? That's what a conjunction does. It hooks up words. And so what David is doing here, he's saying my today is linked to my tomorrows. This conjunction is linking my days on earth with my days in eternity. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all these days of my life, and linking, and I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so that's what I want to think about for a minute. I want to think about this, the place of heaven. David said in Psalm 27, verse 4, he said, one thing I've desired of the Lord, the thing that I seek the most is to live in the house. Think about it. The thing I want more than anything is to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, delighting in the Lord's perfections and meditating in his temple. Listen, if you could ask for one thing, Solomon said, Lord, give me wisdom. David said, Lord, let me dwell in your house. I just want to be in your house. And so really we see he has one request, but it's twofold. He says, while I'm alive, according to Psalm 27, I just want to be in the house of the Lord. I just want to be around God's people. I just want to be around worship. I just want to sing. I want to praise him. I want to hear his truth. I just want to be in the Lord's house. All my days, he said, I was glad when they said, let's go to the house of the Lord. So he just wanted to be in, while he was alive, I just want to be in the house of the Lord. And then he says in Psalm 23, verse 6, and then when I die, man, I want to be in the house of the Lord forever. I want to be in the house of the Lord all my days on earth, but man, I want to be in the house of the Lord all my days in eternity. Isn't that beautiful? That's what he's saying. He said, I want to be in the house of the Lord. And the point I'm trying to make here is this. Is, you know, we talk about heaven. Heaven's going to be great because of this and that and so on and so forth. Listen, the beauty of that place is the Lord, okay? Because that's what he says, the house of the Lord. Paul said, absent from the body, present with the Lord. Not in the beautiful mansion and this and that and all that's true. But he said, no, absent from, but present with the Lord. The beauty of this place is the Lord. God wants your final destination to be heaven. When you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and we talked about that earlier. We said that's a door. Death is a door. And when you go through that door, listen, God wants you to come into his house. You go through that valley, you go through that door, he wants you to come into his house. That's what he wants. And David says, and that's what we have. Because heaven, listen, it's a real place. It is a real place. Jesus talked about this place. It's a familiar passage. I use it at funerals a lot because it's so comforting to me, and I think for families. But he talks about, he said, I'm going to die. He's talking to his disciples. He says, I'm going to die. But here's what he told them. He said, don't let your heart be troubled. Okay, John 14, verse 2. Don't let your heart be troubled. But listen to what he says, picking up in verse 2. He says, in my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, man, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and I'll receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Now, I want you to think about that last phrase, that where I am, you may be also. You say, okay, well, that's pretty good. But listen, a little bit of a mystery there, but it's all cleared up in John 17 when Jesus is praying for his disciples. That's you and me and his other disciples for sure. But listen to what he prays for them. John 17, 24. Father, I desire that those also whom you've given me, talking about his 11 disciples, and that's you and me, any other disciple of Christ, follower of Christ, he said, I desire that they may be with me where I am. Now look at this. Why? To see my glory. See, he's saying that they may be with me. He says, in my Father's house are many dwelling places. And he said, if it weren't so, I would tell you so. But he says, I want you to be there where I am. I want us to be together. Why? So that you may behold my glory. See, that's why I say the beauty of this place is the glory of the Lord. Man, listen, that's a timeless truth. I should have made that a timeless truth. The beauty of heaven is the glory of the Lord. The beauty of heaven is the glory of the Lord. And so and notice he says, and it's going to be forever. I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Listen, how long is a billion years? Man, that's a long time. What about a trillion years? Man, it seems forever. But you know what I think about when I think about how long is forever? I think about that song. When we've been there 10,000 years. Hey, listen, you could say when we've been there 10 trillion years, bright shining as the sun. Guess what? We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. We've been there 10 trillion years and we hadn't lost any time. We still get all the time in the world to sing his praise. Amen. All of our days. That's what he said, I get to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And the beauty of that place is the Lord. All right, the last thing. The benefits of his pursuit, that's goodness and mercy. The beauty of his place, that's the Lord. But now the blessing of his people. I want you to write out beside that the word household. He says, I'll dwell in the house. In the Hebrew, it depicts this word, and part of that meaning of that word, the root meaning of that word is household. And it makes sense, does it not? That the household needs a house. The household are the people. And so the people need a place. The household needs a house. And so it's the house. And that's what Jesus was talking about, was it not? When he says, in my Father's house are many dwelling places, many mansions. Well, why do you need many mansions? Why do you need many dwelling places? For the children of God. And so the blessing, one of the blessings of that place is, man, the family of God is going to be there. Mark Twain said, I'll take heaven for climate and hell for company. Not me, brother. I'll take heaven for climate, and I'll take heaven for company as well. Because I want to be around the saints. I want to be around the family of God. I want to be around those saints I don't know, and I want to be around those saints that I do know. Maybe people I've led to the Lord. I want to be around my own personal family who know the Lord. And that's the blessing of this place, is the household of God. And David, you say, well, do we, and I get to ask this a lot of times, especially at funerals and things, will I see my loved one again? And I'll ask them, did they know the Lord? Yes. Do you know the Lord? Yes. Yes, you'll see him again. So if you know the Lord, you will see. That's what David was talking about there in 2 Samuel. He lost a son. The son had died. And man, he was upset about that. And he went through all this stuff with his attendants and so forth. And finally he told his attendants, he said, man, I can fast and pray, but I can't bring this child back. But here's what he said. He said, I can go be with that child. And it's the same David who's writing this. The same David who says, I'm going to go to that child, is the same David who said, we're going to dwell in the household of the Lord forever. And that's the beauty. That's the blessing of this place called heaven. Now, let me just wrap it. I want to wrap this message up. I want to wrap this series up. And let me just do it this way. I was down at the Bonadilla Trails the other day. I was slogging around trying to do my few miles. And I saw this guy. And he was I just assumed maybe he was National Guard or military or something, because he had this backpack on, and it was a huge backpack. I mean, if you looked at it, it started right here, right below his waist, and it went above his head. It was a huge backpack, and it was packed. You couldn't have slid a pencil into that backpack. It was packed, and I thought to myself, how much does that thing weigh? I mean, it just must weigh a ton. And what a relief and what a blessing. And he was running. He was running with that thing on. His face was red. He was sweating profusely. And I was just thinking, man, I've got some baggage around my belly. I don't have near the baggage he has on his back. And I thought, what a blessing it must have been when he got to the car and he released those snaps and laid that burden down. And you know what, I thought, for some reason, I was wrapping this sermon up, and I had a different thing I was going to share with you, and I thought about this. And you know what, maybe it got me to looking on, I Googled it and looked it up, and I thought, how much does it weigh? How much does that backpack weigh? And so I found several sites, and one of the ones I found was so interesting, was that it said, ideally, a military backpack full will weigh about 33% of that person's body weight. And that's ideally. But they said it can go, if they have to carry ammo and a lot of gear and so forth, they said it could go up, now get this, to 50% of their body weight. Now, I don't want to get too personal here, and because I'm a lean, mean, fighting machine. You know what I'm talking about. But if I was carrying a backpack that was 50% of my weight, let's just say it in a nice way, that would be over 100 pounds. And I couldn't do it. Not run around 3 miles. I just couldn't do it. There's no way I could do it. How heavy it would be. And it made me think of all these people who are carrying burdens. They're carrying baggage. And this COVID-19 crisis has just added weight to the baggage. And so here's how I want to conclude this message in this series. I want to put our little review screen up for you. And so let's put that up. And the title of it is Certainty for Uncertain Times, or for Times of Uncertainty. And so you look there on the left, and what you see are, and from verses 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, you see these things we've been talking about. Provision, peace, purpose, presence, preparation, and promise. Now here's what I want to do. I was thinking, okay, if that's what's certain, what is uncertain? And so let's go through them one by one, and we'll be through very quickly. What's the opposite of his provision? Well, needs. Unmet needs, really. And so some people are carrying around this burden of unmet needs. I need a job. I need, my check is gone. I need money. I'm like that grandmother. I need to feed the kids. And they've got this burden. And listen, here's what I'm telling you. Here's what David's telling us. Here's what God's telling us. You can unsnap and lay that burden down because you can be certain of his provision. Okay? What about peace? People, what's the opposite of that? Be worry to me, anxiety. I'm worried about this. I'm worried about that. And people, listen, I know people, they're carrying around this burden of worry and anxiety. But listen, you can release it and lay it down. Why? Because you have the, if the Lord is your shepherd, you have the certainty of his peace. Number three, his purpose. I think of chaos. I think of uncertainty. Things we just don't know what's going to happen. We don't know what's going on. Listen, you can lay that burden down because we have the certainty of his purpose. Number four, his presence. What's the opposite? Well, if the opposite of his presence, it has to be isolation or loneliness, or I feel like I'm in this all by myself and I'm stuck here in this house and I don't want to go and I got to stay away from people and all of this stuff and can't even see my family. And so, listen, you can lay that burden down because you have the certainty of his presence. He's promised his presence. Number five, his preparation. We talked about how God prepares us through salvation and sanctification, even in the midst of our enemies. But listen, sometimes people feel insecure. They feel they have doubt and they wonder and all of this kind of stuff. You can cast that burden aside because you have the certainty of his preparation. He's prepared you for anything and everything you'll face in this life. And then finally, his promise. What's the hopelessness? Impossible things or impossible situations, and I just don't know. And so we go through all these things. You can lay that burden down because you have the certainty of God's promises, okay? And so I look at how much those things must weigh, our unmet needs and our worry, our anxiety, our chaos, uncertainty, isolation, loneliness, doubt, insecurity, hopelessness, all those things. And I think about that guy with that backpack, probably weighed half of his weight, and what a relief it must have been. And so what I'm saying to you is, man, why don't you lay that stuff down? Why don't you lay the burden down? Listen, there's a verse Jesus said, Psalm 55, verse 22, cast your burden on me. Listen to what he said. He said, he will sustain you. Listen, if you'll just lay those things down, you say, but I don't know what's going to happen. Lay it down. But I'm worried about that. Just lay it down. I don't know where I'm going to get a job. Lay it down. I'm just saying, if you'll just lay it down, he will sustain you. And Jesus even said, if you'll cast your burden on me, I'll give you rest. I'll give you rest. So here's what I would suggest you do today. Unsnap the burden, unsnap the baggage, and lay it down. I know it's uncertain. I know these are crazy times, but set it down today, right now. But here's what's going to happen tomorrow. You're going to get up, and you know what you're going to do? You're going to reach over there to pick them up again. Your worry, your anxiety, your loneliness, your isolation, your chaos, your confusion, you're going to want to put it right back on. But I'm saying this. Instead of reaching for those burdens again, that baggage again, why don't you reach for Psalm 23 again? Like we said in the very first message, taste them again for the first time. And let the peace of God, the provision of God, the protection, let that just wash all over you and find certainty for uncertain times. Can you say it as David declared it with great confidence? The Lord is my shepherd. Can you say that today? Listen, I pray you can. If we can help you, contact us. Our information will be at the bottom of the screen. You call the church, you email us. If we can help you, we want to take you through the scriptures and help you to find this wonderful Savior who went to a cross and died in your place for your sin. He wants to be your shepherd. Listen, you can follow him and his goodness and mercy will follow you if you'll but receive him. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the truths of this psalm. And Lord, in these uncertain times, man, we need something certain. We need something rock solid. And Lord, this psalm, I think, just gives it in bucket loads. And I pray you'll use it and have you to touch people's hearts. And like people, Lord, we may not even know, watching right now, those divine appointments, would you touch them? Lord, would you, just like we saw how you chase us, even in the midst of our failure, you chase us down. Lord, would you just chase after them? And I pray they would turn to you and receive you unto themselves, where they could honestly say today, the Lord, the Master, Lord and Master is my shepherd. I pray that for Jesus' sake, and in your name I ask it. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning. I hope and pray that you've been blessed. And let me just remind you, June 7th is the plan. Now, if it changes, we'll let you know. We're waiting for some more information to come out maybe even this week. And so we'll be letting you know about that. But currently, right now, the plan is to June 7th for us to meet back together. And hopefully in our sanctuary, we'll let you know more about that. Hey, listen, if we can help you, let us know. I love you. I love being your pastor. I pray for you regularly. Would you pray for me? All right? Because I need God's mercy and grace and his goodness in my life. And so you pray for me as we try to lead our flock, okay? God bless you. You have a great rest of this day, Ezra Nash Paxton's birthday. All right? We'll see you soon.
Blessed Redeemer.